Liang Kikeo. Liang Kikeo, courtesy name Zhuoru, art name Rengong, was a Chinese scholar, journalist, philosopher, and reformist who lived during the late Qing Dynasty and the early Republic of China. He inspired Chinese scholars with his writings and reform movements. Liang Kikeo was born in a small village in Xinhui, Guangdong Province on February 23, 1873. Liang's father, Liang Baoying, was a farmer and local scholar, but a classical background that emphasized on tradition and education for ethnic rejuvenescence allowed him to be introduced to various literary works at 6 years old. By the age of 9, Liang started writing thousand-word essays and became a district school student soon after. Liang had two wives, Li Huixian and Wang Giquan. They gave birth to 9 children, all of whom became successful individuals through Liang's strict and effective education. 3 of them were scientific personnel at the Chinese Academy of Sciences, including Liang Sichen, the prominent historian of Chinese architecture. Liang passed the Zhihokai degree provincial examination at the age of 11. In 1884, he undertook the arduous task of studying for the traditional governmental exams. At the age of 16, he passed the Juran second-level provincial exams and was the youngest successful candidate at that time. In 1890, Liang failed in his Jinshi degree national examinations in Beijing and never earned a higher degree. He took the exams along with Kong Yawei, a famous Chinese scholar and reformist. According to one popular narrative of Liang's failure to pass the Jinshi, the examiner was determined to flunk Kong for his heterodox challenge to existing institutions, but since the exams were all anonymous, he could only presume that the exam with the most unorthodox views was Kang's. Instead, Kong disguised himself by writing an examination 8-legged essay espousing traditionalist ideas and passed the exam while Liang's paper was assumed to be Kang's and picked out to be failed. Inspired by the book A Short Account of the Maritime Circuit, Liang became extremely interested in Western ideologies. After returning home, Liang went on to study with Kong Yawei, who was teaching at Wanmiu Kaitang in Guangzhou. Kang's teachings about foreign affairs fueled Liang's interest in reforming China. In 1895, Liang went to the capital Beijing again with Kong for the national examination. During the examination, he was a leader of the Gongshangshu movement. After failing to pass the examination for a second time, he stayed in Beijing to help Kong publish domestic and foreign information. He also helped to organize the Society for National Strengthening, where Liang served as secretary. For time, he was also enlisted by the governor of Hunan, Chen Beijin, to edit reform-friendly publications, such as the Hunan Daily and the Hunan Journal. As an advocate of constitutional monarchy, Liang was unhappy with the governance of the Qing government and wanted to change the status quo in China. He organized reforms with Kong Yawei by putting their ideas on paper and sending them to the Guangxu Emperor of the Qing Dynasty. This movement is known as the Wuxi Reform or the Hundred Days Reform. Their proposal asserted that China was in need of more than self-strengthening, and called for many institutional and ideological changes such as getting rid of corruption and remodeling the state examination system. Liang thus was a major influence in the debates on democracy in China. This proposal soon ignited a frenzy of disagreement, and Liang became a wanted man by order of Empress Dowager Cixi, the leader of the political conservative faction who later took over the government as regent. Cixi strongly opposed reforms at that time and, along with her supporters, condemned the 100 Days Reform as being too radical. In 1898, the conservative coup ended all reforms, and Liang fled to Japan, where he stayed for the next 14 years. While in Tokyo, he befriended the influential politician and future Japanese Prime Minister Inukai Tsuyoshi. In Japan, he continued to actively advocate the democratic cause by using his writings to raise support for the reformers' cause among overseas Chinese and foreign governments. He continued to emphasize the importance of individualism, and to support the concept of a constitutional monarchy as opposed to the radical republicanism supported by the Tokyo-based Tong Menghui. During his time in Japan, Liang also served as a benefactor and colleague to Fan Boi Chow, one of Vietnam's most important anti-colonial revolutionaries. In 1899, Liang went to Canada, where he met Dr. Sun Yat-sen among others, then to Honolulu in Hawaii. During the Boxer Rebellion, Liang was back in Canada, where he formed the Chinese Empire Reform Association. This organization later became the Constitutionalist Party, which advocated constitutional monarchy. While Sun promoted revolution, Liang preached reform. In 1900 to 1901, Liang visited Australia on a six-month tour which aimed at raising support for a campaign to reform the Chinese Empire in order to modernize China through adopting the best of Western technology, industry, and government systems. He also gave public lectures to both Chinese and Western audiences around the country. This visit coincided with the federation of the six British colonies into the new nation of Australia in 1901. He felt this model of integration might well be copied in the diverse regions of China. He was feted by politicians, and met the first Prime Minister of Australia, Edmund Barton. He returned to Japan later that year. In 1903, Liang embarked on an eight-month lecture tour throughout the United States, which included a meeting with President Theodore Roosevelt in Washington, D.C., before returning to Japan via Vancouver, British Columbia, Canada. The Confucius descendant Duke Yanzhong was proposed for replacing the Qing dynasty as emperor by Liang Kikeo. With the overthrow of the Qing dynasty, constitutional monarchy became an increasingly irrelevant topic. Liang merged his renamed Democratic Party with the Republicans to form the new Progressive Party. He was very critical of Sun Yat-sen's attempts to undermine President Yuan Shikai. Though usually supportive of the government, he opposed the expulsion of the nationalists from parliament. In 1915, he opposed Yuan's attempt to make himself emperor. He convinced his disciple Caie, the military governor of Yunnan, to rebel. Progressive Party branches agitated for the overthrow of Yuan and more provinces declared their independence. The revolutionary activity that he had frowned upon was utilized successfully. Besides Duan Kaiyue, Liang was the biggest advocate of entering World War I on the Allied side. He felt it would boost China's status and ameliorate foreign debts. He condemned his mentor, Kong Yahweh, for assisting in the failed attempt to restore the Qing in July 1917. After failing to turn Duan and Feng Xuozhang into responsible statesmen, he left politics. Lin Yutang once called Liang the greatest personality in the history of Chinese journalism, while Joseph Levinson, author of Liang Chichao and the Mind of Modern China, described Liang as a brilliant scholar, journalist, and political figure. Liang Kikeo was the most influential turn-of-the-century scholar-journalist, according to Levinson. Liang showed that newspapers and magazines could serve as an effective medium for communicating political ideas. Liang, as a historian and a journalist, believed that both careers must have the same purpose and moral commitment, as he proclaimed, "By examining the past and revealing the future, I will show the path of progress to the people of the nation." Thus, he founded his first newspaper, called the Qing Yibao, named after a student movement of the Han Dynasty. Liang's exile to Japan allowed him to speak freely and exercise his intellectual autonomy. During his career in journalism, he edited two premier newspapers, Zhonghuai Gongbao and Chaiwabao. He also published his moral and political ideals in Qing Yibao and New Citizen. In addition, he used his literary works to further spread his views on republicanism both in China and across the world. Accordingly, he had become an influential journalist in terms of political and cultural aspects by writing new forms of periodical journals. Furthermore, journalism paved the way for him to express his patriotism. Liang produced a widely read bi-weekly journal called New Citizen, first published in Yokohama, Japan on February 8, 1902. The journal covered many different topics, including politics, religion, law, economics, business, geography, and current and international affairs. In the journal, Liang coined many Chinese equivalents for never-before-heard theories or expressions and used the journal to help communicate public opinion in China to faraway readers. Through news analyses and essays, Liang hoped that the new citizen would be able to start a new stage in Chinese newspaper history. A year later, Liang and his co-workers saw a change in the newspaper industry and remarked, "Since the inauguration of our journal last year, there have come into being almost 10 separate journals with the same style and design." Liang spread his notions about democracy as chief editor of the New Citizen Journal. The journal was published without hindrance for 5 years but eventually ceased in 1907 after 96 issues. Its readership was estimated to be 200,000. As one of the pioneers of Chinese journalism of his time, Liang believed in the power of newspaper, especially its influence over government policies. Using newspapers and magazines to communicate political ideas, Liang realized the importance of journalism's social role and supported the idea of a strong relationship between politics and journalism before the May 4th movement. He believed that newspapers and magazines should serve as an essential and effective tool in communicating political ideas. He believed that newspapers did not only act as a historical record, but was also a means to shape the course of history. Press is a weapon in revolution. Liang also thought that the press was an effective weapon in the service of a nationalist uprising. In Liang's words, the newspaper is a revolution of ink, not a revolution of blood. He wrote, "So a newspaper regards the government the way a father or elder brother regards a son or younger brother, teaching him when he does not understand, and reprimanding him when he gets something wrong." Undoubtedly, his attempt to unify and dominate a fast-growing and highly competitive press market has set the tone for the first generation of newspaper historians of the May 4th movement. Newspaper as an educational program. Liang was well aware that the newspaper could serve as an educational program, and said, "The newspaper gathers virtually all the thoughts and expressions of the nation and systematically introduces them to the citizenry, it being irrelevant whether they are important or not, concise or not, radical or not. The press, therefore, can contain, reject, produce, as well as destroy, everything." For example, Liang wrote a well-known essay during his most radical period titled "The Young China" and published it in his newspaper Qing Yi Bao on February 2, 1900. The essay established the concept of the nation-state and argued that the young revolutionaries were the holders of the future of China. This essay was influential on the Chinese political culture during the May 4th movement in the 1920s. Weak press, however. Liang thought that the press in China at that time was quite weak, not only due to lack of financial resources and to conventional social prejudices, but also because the social atmosphere was not free enough to encourage more readers and there was a lack of roads and highways that made it hard to distribute newspapers. Liang felt that the prevalent newspapers of the time were no more than a mass commodity. He criticized that those newspapers failed to have the slightest influence upon the nation as a society. Liang Kikeo was both a traditional Confucian scholar and a reformist. Liang Kikeo contributed to the reform in late Qing by writing various articles interpreting non-Chinese ideas of history and government, with the intent of stimulating Chinese citizens' minds to build a new China. In his writings, he argued that China should protect the ancient teachings of Confucianism, but also learn from the successes of Western political life and not just Western technology. Therefore, he was regarded as the pioneer of political fiction. Liang shaped the ideas of democracy in China, using his writings as a medium to combine Western scientific methods with traditional Chinese historical studies. Liang's works were strongly influenced by the Japanese political scholar Kat Hiroyuki, who used methods of social Darwinism to promote the statist ideology in Japanese society. Liang drew from much of his work and subsequently influenced Korean nationalists in the 1900s. Liang Kikeo's historiographical thought represents the beginning of modern Chinese historiography and reveals some important directions of Chinese historiography in the 20th century. For Liang, the major flaw of old historians was their failure to foster the national awareness necessary for a strong and modern nation. Liang's call for new history not only pointed to a new orientation for historical writing in China, but also indicated the rise of modern historical consciousness among Chinese intellectuals. He advocated the great man theory in his 1899 piece, Heroes and the Times, and he also wrote biographies of European state builders such as Otto von Bismarck, Horatio Nelson, Oliver Cromwell, Lajos Kossuth, Giuseppe Mazzini, and Camillo Benso, Count of Cavour, as well as Chinese men including Zhang He, Tan Sitong, and Wang Anqi. During this period of Japan's challenge in the First Sino-Japanese War, Liang was involved in protests in Beijing pushing for an increased participation in the governance by the Chinese people. It was the first protest of its kind in modern Chinese history. This changing outlook on tradition was shown in the historiographical revolution launched by Liang Kikeo in the early 20th century. Frustrated by his failure at political reform, Liang embarked upon cultural reform. In 1902, while in exile in Japan, Liang wrote the new historiography, which called on Chinese to study world history to understand China rather than just Chinese history. The article also attacked old historiographical methods, which he lamented focused on dynasty over state, the individual over the group, the past but not the present, and facts, rather than ideals. Liang was head of the Translation Bureau and oversaw the training of students who were learning to translate Western works into Chinese. He believed that this task was the most essential of all essential undertakings to accomplish because he believed Westerners were successful, politically, technologically, and economically. Philosophical works, after escaping Beijing and the government crackdown on anti-Qing protesters, Liang studied the works of Western philosophers of the Enlightenment period, namely Hobbes, Rousseau, Locke, Hume, and Bentham, translating them and introducing his own interpretation of their works. His essays were published in a number of journals, drawing interest among Chinese intellectuals who had been taken aback by the dismemberment of China's formidable empire at the hands of foreign powers. Western social and political theories, in the early 20th century, Liang Kikeo played a significant role in introducing Western social and political theories in Korea such as social Darwinism and international law. Liang wrote in his well-known manifesto, New People. Liang advocated reform in both the genres of poem and novel. The collected works from the Ice Drinker's Studio is his representative works in literature compiled into 148 volumes. Liang gained his idea of calling his work as collected works of Yinbingshi from a passage of Zhuangzi. It states that every morning, I receive the mandate, every evening I drink the ice, but I remain ardent in my inner mind. As a result, Liang called his workplace as the Ice Drinker Studio, and addressed himself as Yinbingshi Zhuren, literally host of the Ice Drinker Studio, in order to present his idea that he was worrying about all the palatial matters, so he would still try his best to reform the society by the effort of writings. Liang also wrote fiction and scholarly essays on fiction, which included Fleeing to Japan After Failure of 100 Days Reform and the essay on the relationship between fiction and the government of the people. These novels emphasized modernization in the West and the call for reform. In the late 1920s, Liang retired from politics and taught at the Tungnan University in Shanghai and the Tsinghua Research Institute in Peking as a tutor. He founded Changsu Shi and brought many intellectual figures to China, including Driesch and Tagore. Academically, he was a renowned scholar of his time, introducing Western learning and ideology, and making extensive studies of ancient Chinese culture. During this last decade of his life, he wrote many books documenting Chinese cultural history, Chinese literary history and historiography. Liang re-examined the works of Mozi, and authored, amongst other works, The Political Thought of the Pre-Qing Period, and Intellectual Trends in the Qing Period. He also had a strong interest in Buddhism and wrote numerous historical and political articles on its influence in China. Liang influenced many of his students in producing their own literary works. They included Su Haimo, renowned modern poet, and Wang Li, an accomplished poet and founder of Chinese linguistics as a modern discipline. Liang Sishun, Liang Sichun, and Liang Sizhuang were born by Li Huixian. Liang Siyang, Liang Sizhong, Liang Sida, Liang Siyi, Liang Xining, and Liang Silai were born by Wang Giquan. Liang's pedigree book was once lost with only one page left. The family members recreated the naming method by giving 16 characters in a sequence, each generation following one. Liang didn't follow it by using to his children.